god, I've lost my...
Okay, sorry.
My interface was just totally wonky there, but I fixed it. It's fine now. I can actually see what's going on. Okay, so funky opening. Hatch, pool, hatch, double queen. This is specific hatch, for this hatch. Map, right?
No, actually. I really like this opening. I feel like it times everything out like really beautifully. And I feel like I'm pretty immune to most early game crap, except for maybe 3-Rex Reaper, which obviously delayed speed perks.
I'm guessing you're not playing against Hellion drop into, like, Hellion elevator morph Hellbats, and then Hellions or Hellions Hellbats run by at the front at the same time?
I mean, I play against Hellion, Hellbat pushes happen, Hellion cyclone happens, but Hellion drop is weird to me.
Okay, that's, like, really popular at top level at the moment, and that shit destroys this sort of opening, because you don't have the mobility to get around, they can just stay in Hellion form, or they can morph into Hellbats, and it just gets, like, really awkward. Generally speaking, this is very similar to an opening we saw get very popular in December, because Terrans aren't SCV scouting most of the time, but you'd open up with pool first on most maps, because you want to delay the Reaper, so he can't come in and be a pain in the ass, and so that you can potentially delay the command center.
Either with no speed.
Delayed speed. You get very delayed speed so that it kicks in right around 5 minutes when double drops can start happening.
Exactly. That's how my speed in this build is timed, is the speed starts at 3:30 or 3:45 and it finishes by 5 minutes so that you have it by the
I was thinking it was the same because I didn't know the gas timing of that build. And I'm like, this looks very similar to that build. So I would definitely... I'm not an expert on this build. I haven't played it much. I've watched a lot of it. So let me start writing some notes over here. Coaching. And what is the date? Today's like, what, the 22nd or something? All right, 22nd, 23rd. Easy peasy.
Also, on this map, I've been taken to destroying these back blocks to deal with liberator crap. I don't know if you've had any experience with this. But I find that a lot of people on this map like to go ranged liberators, and it's total bullshit.
Oh yeah, I saw that once.
That's the idea, is that by doing this, you can get queens back there and kill the one, at least the one at your third, like, having access to the back area more easily.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Also, drops down there, if you don't have those rocks down, they can kind of just drop, pick up, and be annoying. So I think that's a really good foresight to take that down. That's something I need to do more in my play as well. Go pool first. Continue.
I've also found that, as crazy as just getting a drop lord, putting four queens and a dropper lord, you can drop underneath the what do you call them, liberators?
Oh, yeah.
It works surprisingly well.
Can you reach the ones in the main and natural, though? I think the main... maybe they can only deny two patches, right? Yeah, they can probably...
this drop gets shut down.
Okay. So do you just blind counter that 5 minute push? Like every single game? Blind counter,
but like you're ready for it every single game, yeah.
This is a blind counter. Look how many lings he made. You don't make 50 lings for no reason.
But I mean, so the thing is, the two medevac drop hits at about the same time as the Hellion Cyclone bullshit, which hits at about the same time as the Hellbat push. So you just expect a push between like maybe 4:45 and 5:30. You just expect some sort of push. And it doesn't matter which one it is. If you just have a million Zerglings, you kill it.
How many queens do we have right now? Only six. Okay, yeah, there is a little bit of weakness here. This is like reasonably solid up to a decent level. But against a lot of the different Hellion builds, you don't really want to build this many Zerglings and you kind of want more queens. The Zerglings can sometimes deal with it, but sometimes they can't if they're,
I thought six queens was kind of a lot. I'm interested in that feedback.
No, I mean, you're playing Ling Bane Muta, right, off this?
Yeah. Mostly Ling Bane, and then maybe a few Mutas.
Because you've really got to delay the Mutas, you know, a lot with the current style. It's all about the fourth base, the macro hatch, which you're focusing on really well here. So I'm very happy with that. The queens are really important just to take down Liberators, take down Medivacs, but also because they defend Hellbat timings so well. So if your opponent goes for one of these giant 10-12 Hellbat timings and they just keep them in a ball, the Zerglings just aren't going to do anything. So
I've had with the Banelings for that. If I scout Hellions at all, I put down an early Bane nest and then just have the queens and plow some Banelings into that ball.
So that's your response. Okay. I think you can make this work reasonably well. I think you probably want to have less Zerglings if they are doing a Hellion opening, just because it's a little bit excessive. You're also, just generally something I've been talking to about a lot of Zergs, is people are rushing their upgrades and then struggling against Hellion openings. So
yep.
just remember, you can always delay your upgrades versus a Hellion opening. Terran's not going to go Hellion, double eBay, third CC, unless he wants to die to literally anything the Zerg wants to do. And I think it's pretty rare for players to do that on ladder at the moment. So generally speaking, their upgrades are heaps delayed. Yours can be heaps delayed. Against those more mobile forms, whether it's Banshee, follow-up, Liberator, Hellbats, whatever, they always commit more to it. They need to do more damage than with a more typical Marine-focused play, which is more focused around just forcing you to build units. So if you just defend and have a good economy, then you win the game, usually.
Right.
You get ahead, you get in a really good position. And upgrades aren't as important. So just keep in mind, obviously this isn't a Hellion game, so we're not seeing that here, but that's something we might come across. Versus Hellion openings, you know, delay upgrades, and don't pump quite so many lings. I think, what time do you drop your Baneling Nest if you do see a Hellion opening?
As soon as I see Hellions. Like, I don't know what the timing is. It's just like literally if I see Hellions.
Okay, that's way too early then, because Hellions can come out at like 3 minutes. You want to drop it at like...
Oh, no, I think they usually come at maybe 4... I would say 4:30 is when I usually see them.
Yeah. A Hellbat timing can hit you from about 5 minutes. So, yeah, if right. you drop it at about absolute latest, 4 minutes 30, anything from right. 4 minutes, 4 minutes 30 should be okay.
That's what I normally see. There are times yeah. where the first, if there's a very, very quick Hellbat push, I don't have the Bane Nest up, but then you just kill it with the six queens and the million Zerglings, and it's not a problem.
Okay, cool. In terms of creep spread, I like that you're not putting down too many tumors. I hate when people spam tumors and then don't spread the active tumors and just keep putting down fresh ones. That's like my biggest pet peeve. It's such a waste of APM. and it's slower. It's a lot slower than just, you know, doing it the other way. It looks like you're queuing up injects on your macro hatch, and is that something you kind of send back the extra queens, queue up injects, and then bring them back?
No, I don't do that on purpose.
Okay.
It is possible that happens sometimes, but it's definitely not on purpose.
All right, I'm gonna watch something real quick. So we're in this mid game now. I'm on your camera, I'm gonna try and watch one of your macro cycles. Now, how many hatcheries are you injecting at this stage of the game? Do you inject every single one or?
Five. I think the fourth is sometimes goes uninjected, just because I mechanically am bad. But certainly the main three and the macro hatch should be injected, I think. So I think I should have at least four hatcheries being injected at all times. It looks like somehow maybe actually my queen from my third, it wandered over to my fourth, and maybe I'm injecting there instead of my third.
Right.
But similar idea.
Okay, cool. Yeah, if you're ever struggling with spending your money, you really do need to dump those excess injects into extra hatcheries. Looking at your hotkeys, number one, is that your creep queens?
No, that is... So the way I hotkey my early game is that I have my main queen on 5, my natural queen who just died on 6, and then the rest of the queens are like the task force at the front, and they all go on 1, and that's like the third queen, yeah. as well as the creep queens, and just like the general defense people who are like running around, and like probably the ones in an engagement.
That's interesting. So even your third queen goes on that hotkey, and then what, you just yep. have to constantly bring it back from injecting?
Sure.
How are you injecting again? Are you just selecting the queens manually or what?
I hotkey the queens. Like okay. they're on 5, 6,
oh, so eight. I forgot. You're doing that old inject method. Okay, right. You're doing, legacy mechanics. Same way I used to do it, except I'd hotkey the hatchery as well. That's some old school stuff. That's acceptable. You can get to super high level with that. I'm not going to force you to change that. Are you using camera hotkeys though?
Some, not a lot.
Yeah, if you're using that inject method, you're not going to use them a lot. If at some point you want to learn that, you want to grind out some, you know,
yep.
new mechanical technique, you can change it up. Okay, I'm just trying to really understand exactly how you were doing things there for a moment, because that didn't come up so much yep. in the ZVZ where it was all about the action. All right, so you've got spare hotkey on number 3.
Yep.
4, 5, 6. And then you've got W as yeah. well. Are you using W right now in this game? It looks like you're not, yeah?
W is 9 if I rebound it. I don't know. I don't use it very frequently.
Okay. So what 3. We see here is he's dropping a bit, and I notice you haven't really been stealing your units off your control group at all to deal with that, which is just kind of inviting the Terran to keep dropping and really pull you around. As soon as you see a Terran starts dropping, I think just always split off 20 Zerglings, 2 Banelings. Just leave them in your main base on a separate hotkey. It's going to make your life a lot easier. So yeah, is that something you're kind of, you have that as a habit at all, being just like box Zerglings, Banelings, alt 3, so or whatever your control group's stealing? Yeah, like, are you using the control group stealing mechanic for that?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, okay. Exactly. Awesome. I don't usually do it on 3. I usually do it on 9 or 0,
okay.
Which is now W, which I should have done more this game.
Okay,
but
awesome.
The reason for that is because if I have infestors on 3, so infestors to me are what go on 3. And once they go on 3, if you accidentally, like, alt 3, you unhockey your infestors and lose 1,000 minerals worth of, or 1,000 gas worth of stuff really quick.
Okay, cool. All right, so a couple key things. Without changing up your core mechanics, letting you do things the way you already are,
yep.
Injects are obviously very important, but what I see you doing is you're wasting a lot of APM in this game. So what you're doing is you're trying to inject, and put it on your camera, and you can see this, you're trying to inject every single hatchery. Some of them yep. you don't even have hotkeyed. It's just hard. It's hard to hotkey more than 3 hatcheries because you don't do that in your other matchups. You're not playing Massling Bane. So what makes your life a lot easier is to always have your inject and your sort of core macro as a set cycle where you do it exactly the yep. same every single game. So rather than trying to inject all these new hatcheries, I really think what's going to make things easier for yourself is just inject the 3 hatcheries. Don't inject anymore and try to inject them well and regularly, but you do not want to disrupt that cycle because what's happening is you're going inject, inject, inject. Okay, also inject the macro hatch, also inject the 4th base. And because that takes so long, you're not always spending your lava right after injecting. You're not always kind of completing your macro cycle. And I feel like you're getting behind on your tasks a little bit.
So I think that exactly for the reason you just said is why often I don't inject my 4th. My 4th tier is not injected. The macro hatch is very easy to inject because since I hotkey the queens, I just hotkey both of the 2 main queens on 5.
Yep.
And then when I do 5, it's just inject, inject, and then 6 inject, 7 inject. And that's okay. really easy. And you can get in the macro cycle
yeah.
with the macro hatch, but the 4th gets left behind.
Okay. There was once or twice where you did inject the 4th. I definitely saw that. But definitely, it's something, as long as you don't do that too much, and it's not something you're doing every game, that's good. But yeah, a really important thing to remember is in a game like this, bam, 7 minutes, you've got such a beautiful setup. And
yeah, exactly.
What you need to exactly. do here is just grab those creep queens. Look at how much energy they've got. Check that shit out. That is beautiful, man.
Yep.
That energy yep. needs to be dumped into the macro hatch and the 4th base right now. You don't need a lot of energy to keep spreading your creep. You're not using a lot of tumors. But if you finish your macro hatch now, or if you're used to injecting the macro hatch as well and you like doing that and it's comfortable, okay. you don't need to bother. But at least dump like 10 injects into that 4th base. And that's going to give you 5 minutes of non-stop lava popping out of that hatchery.
Yep.
And it allows your cycle to stay nice and clean. And it gives you a lot of lava. And that's usually difference between floating 2K minerals in the mid game and being like, shit, I just can't spend this and not having to do that. So it's important to try to do that, like, especially if you've got a clean opening like this, as quickly as possible. So you don't have to, do it when there's other things going on. So queue up injects on the 4th base as soon as it finishes. So I'll say queue up, like 10 plus injects on
there. Do you think there's value in keeping some transfuse energy in case there's like liberator crap or, medevac drops that you feel like, is that value to keep it?
I think at the start of the game, my normal pattern is I get 3 creep tumors down and then I don't spread any more creep until after I've held the first pressure, whether that be a fast Hellion attack, a 2-1-1 attack. The moment I sort of defend the first big pressure, it gets to 5 minutes, 30, 6 minutes, 6 minutes, 30. I'm like, bam, throw down all the creep tumors, it's fine. And even if you throw down another 6 or 7 or 8 creep tumors at that point, which is usually more than enough for any map to spread in every direction, you'll have like a lot of energy to still dump into that 4th base. So that should work well. So what we need to talk about here is droning the 3rd. So let's play from here because what you have, droning the 4th. You have beautiful setup, 3 bases, fully saturated. You've got the double gases.
Yep.
You prioritize minerals over gas. You can transfer a few extra workers over to your 4th. As your main runs out in about a minute and a half, two minutes time, you can transfer half of those workers. So you already off this economy can really make use of that 4th base. And what you should be doing here is massing units. And you should only build more drones after you crush a fight and feel super confident. Like if you're in the driver's seat, if you've got creep halfway across the map, if you're basically anything, I'm going to just call it generally the comfort zone. Because I think you're at a high enough level that you can judge for yourself when you can get away with it. But it's something where you do want to be a bit more cautious. Because this game, we're going to see you kind of, your deflect is pressure. And right now you're not building units. Where it's completely
right now I'm not building anything. He's dropping me in 2 places. I'm like freaking out and just trying to A move back and forth. It's ugly.
Just should have used that control group stealing a little bit better there, and that would have been a bit easier. Overall, you do deal with it, but then 24 drones. This was not a, I just crushed your pressure and I creep halfway across the map. This was, this took a bit longer to clean up than it should have. I didn't take any core damage, but I am on the back foot a little bit. You know, I'm a bit behind my spending. You do not want to build 20 drones there. Well, and just generally, think of 80 drones as your maximum drone count. Never above 80 at 80 the most.
So yeah, my thought there was, okay, I held some attack. Let's get the fourth up. And then I stopped droning on the after four. And you're saying I should stop after three or so.
Sorry,
I really wanted to get... I really... Here, I thought, I just held an attack. I want to get the fourth completely up and running, and then I'll stop building drones.
Just
and I guess now I'm back... Well, yeah. Interesting. So I cut drones earlier.
Yeah,
but part of that is your main was... You only have four patches left. Like, you just transfer the drones to your main now, but those drones could have gone to the fourth, and then you don't have to make as many.
Yeah. Because if you think about it, even when you're on only 66 drones, that's three base saturation, by 9 minutes, your main is half mined out. You want to transfer eight workers to your fourth, so already you're making use of half of your fourth. At about 11 minutes, half of your natural will run out. You'll transfer another eight workers down, and you're fully making use of the minerals on your fourth. And you don't really need the gas on your fourth a lot of the time. It's really about the minerals, at least for the initial phase. You can add those gases later. So the key points, and I'm writing these all in your document. So droning the fourth, only do it after you hit your comfort zone. Some games just stay on 66 drones all game long. I did my rule of one gas daily. It was a replay of Snoot versus Keen, and it was on Hab Station, a map with a lot of really good pushing positions. And Snoot was just like, nope, 66 drones all game. Like, let's just always have enough units to defend and focus on staying in control of the game. Because the moment you don't have enough units to like push him back, your opponent can really start dropping everywhere while pushing creep on the front, and you start making mistakes at that point.
That's really interesting. I wouldn't have put together that those drones were bad and that I didn't have enough units because of them. I feel like that there was enough delay in between those two things that I would have not put them together.
Okay.
And the issue here is your positioning more than anything else.
The positioning of what? The army?
The position. Like, you let him take... You basically let him push all the way across the map and then siege up all of his widow mines uncontested.
Exactly. I think that's a big problem. I think that might be why I'm getting myself into trouble with engagements, is because I'm like just not aggressive. I'm just sitting there, like, let the guy get widow mines outside of your fourth, and then like run into them blindly, which seems bad.
Yeah. So let's reassess your goals. Imagining. Let's say we didn't build those 24 drones. What would the game look like from here? And try to visualize this. What is your focus if you're just massing units and you're kind of waiting for the Terran to attack you so you can receive that attack, you can crush it?
Yep.
What's the advantage you get if you're not building drones? Because the Terran will catch up. He'll have a three-base economy, which is bigger than your economy because of mules. And eventually his army will be more efficient. It's all about creep spread, right?
That's interesting. I was going to say the goal to me is get to ultras, get to infestors, and like get the units that the Terran just can't kill ASAP. Creep spread is good too, obviously, and I'm doing my best, but this guy's doing a good job of denying it. And
that's because you built 24 drones, so you gave him more leeway. There's two things. You built 24 drones, and you weren't splitting off the drop squads with the control group stealing. Yep. You changed those two things. You have plentiful units. You can afford to do something like, you know what? I don't have very good map vision right now. I have no idea if he's dropping, but I'm going to put 20 Zerglings in my main base, and I don't even know if they're going to do anything. And I can still defend my creep spread on the front with the rest of my army. And you know what? If you can push back pressure, you immediately get to spread creep an extra screen. You push back another pressure, you've got creep outside the Terran's third, and the Terran mentally almost checks out of the game. Like, the Terran just goes, I'm fucked. Like, you can't push through this. I'm just dead. So it's okay to really delay that Ultra Tech, that Infestor Tech. So rather than thinking of this as sitting back and turtling, the way we did before. Remember, Ultras also aren't as strong. They're still pretty fucking awesome, but they're not as strong with that one less armor these days. And really just look to thrive in this stage of the game. The biggest thing I notice whenever I go and I haven't studied pro play for a little while, I haven't watched or cast a tournament, I start finding myself teching too fast as well. And a lot of people do this. And whenever I watch pro play, I always think, man, you're not going to the next step. You're not, you know, I'm watching this top Korean. Why aren't you going to the next tier? And it's part of just having consistency in their play. There's so many different things that can happen. So they just always commit a lot more to the mid game, and it gives them more units to make plays happen and also to defend their opponent's shit. Because the moment you lose a base, you lose momentum in Legacy, shit starts to just go all over the place, and you make twice as many mistakes. So commit to the mid game a little bit harder, really look to control it. And I think as an exercise, try to just always play on 66 drones Lair only. Mutaling Bane only. No other units. Do not build a hive. You're not allowed to build a hive, or if you do, only for upgrades. Oh, and you're not allowed to drone anymore.
Oh, wow. That sounds super scary to me.
Exactly. And that's why this exercise is perfect for you. Because you will be like, shit, I've got to win with Mutaling Bane. How do I do this? And you're going to be forced to like get way better at spreading your creep across the map. It's all going to be about control the map, shut down drops, spread creep, get sick engagement the moment Terran steps on creep. Because you've kind of got that urgency to make it happen in the mid game. And that's what you're missing right now, is you're kind of sitting back and playing a little bit more of a passive game, and you're letting the Terran dictate the pace.
Are you not just boned if the Terran gets 3-3?
No, not at all. Because Terran's really going to struggle to get a fourth. And because you're committing to more units, your creep spread's going to get all over the map. And then Terran really is threatened to pressure you. It's hard for Terran to even tell that you're just sitting there on no economy. And usually they have to start pushing you. And because you've got more units, there's a huge difference between taking a fight where you're on 85 drones, you're just rolling small squads of Ling Bane into a rally, desperately trying to buy time, and you stop 20 drones less, you have an extra 40 Zerglings, 10 Banelings, you roll in from all sides, overwhelm his push, kill his medevacs with the muters, kill his widow mines, and Terran's just boned. His 3-3 will kick in.
That always feels the best. That's the best feeling.
And that's going to start happening a lot more. And just on top of that, well, how else can you encounter attacks? You're going to start to rely a bit more on counter attacks, especially as the supplies get really big. You go, shit, man, I don't want to fight a 200-200 battle. What can I do? Well, guess what? Yeah. I've got 20 Mutalisks. I can counterattack with those while counterattacking with 80 Zerglings while his depot's down. Yeah. And at the same time, I'll just keep morphing Banelings and clicking them into his army, and I won't even watch them. I don't even need to micro them. Just send 10 Banelings at a time into his parade. And this is like, this is abusing the imbalance of Zerg, right? You got to abuse the things. Think of a salty as fuck Terran player. It's like, I'm ahead, my army's better, but I just can't force the Zerg to fight me in one direct position. And that's kind of what you want to do more and more as the game goes on.
When I'm in the driver's seat, I really like the counterattacks. But when I'm behind and struggling to stay alive, I feel like I can't spare the units. But it seems like if I had 40 more Zerglings, of course I can spare units.
Exactly, yeah. So it starts to make things really interesting. You'll start to play the attention game a lot more. You send the counterattack in. And first, you go in with your army. So you threaten with your army. Instantly, Terran double taps his army hotkey, starts splitting and stimming like a madman. Your counterattack gets through, the depot never gets raised. Even when you're playing most pro players, they won't raise the depot if you do that. Alternatively, you say, nah, I want to crush his main army right now. I'm going to send the counterattack in first. He's going to, bam, go to his depot, whether it's a camera location, whatever. He's going to raise the depot, reset his rally, stim the units, look back at his army. Fuck, he's slightly slower on the spread. Some of his widow mines aren't burrowed, and your main engagement goes better. So keep in mind, both sides of ZvT is very APM intensive. So both of you can totally screw each other simply by pulling the other guy's attention away when you make a decisive move. Because you're going to be forcing yourself to stay on less economy, once you get in the mid game, it's literally just spend money. Just spend money. Build Ling Bane, inject, find things to do with my Ling Bane muter. And you're going to have a lot more focus on the tactical maneuvers, the counterattacks, and all that sort of stuff.
Seems legit.
All right, so I'm just going to write out this note very quickly, and then we'll hop into a game with QXC here. So, exercise. Basically, this is your homework for at least the first week of or the next week of ZvT for you. 66 drones, no more. Only use fourth base onward for transferring workers. You don't need gas on the fourth for a very long time. No hive. No hive. Nothing but Ling, Bane, Muta. And I would also say don't focus too much on a super high Muta count. Sometimes you can do that. Focus more on the Ling, Bane, Ling. Taking good engagements, doing good counterattacks. Because a lot of players try to focus too much on the Mutas, and it's not as reliable. Right. It's more about the frontal engagements and the counterattacks.
Especially in Legacy. In Hearts, you could do that in Legacy.
Yeah, because your tech would hit the field a lot sooner if you went for a tech build. But it just doesn't happen in Legacy of the Void. If you don't build your solid economy at the start, you can try to get your tech up, but it's always balanced on a knife's edge, which is why everyone was so shocked when Scarlet actually took down like Innovation and Beyond in Nation Wars with two base Muta, because it's like, this isn't meant to work anymore. Like, Terrans are destroying this. And then there was a couple of weeks where all the Zergs in Korea were doing two base Muta, and they made it work for a few days, and then they all started getting crushed again because the Terrans just got too good at you know, protecting against the tech. And what map do you guys want? Anything in particular? Newkirk?
Doesn't matter.
All right. Your host, actually. Austin. Oh, so you can host up Newkirk. make sure you choose the right server for both of you. I think it should be fine. Like, you guys should just have best match on, so it should host on a US server if you're hosting it. Oh, no, you made me the party leader? Okay, I gotta leave party. Because otherwise I'll put you both on the AU server until I change my settings. So let me go in and change that. Oh, it's on Central. Is Central fine for you guys?
We're both East, but whatever. It's not a huge deal. All
right, that's cool. I'll rehost on East. No worries.
Newkirk, Precinct, TE.
Are you leader, Kevin?
Yeah, I'm leader. Pig, just join all hosts.
Okay. Oh, okay. All right, no worries, man. Send me a party invite again.
Yep. I think you need to be my friend. Oh, there we go.
All good. Make me a ref and go whenever you guys are ready.
Yeah, let's do it.
Ready?
Yep, so you guys probably want to mute your mics so you don't hear each other's, you know, sounds or whatever. I'm going to mute my mic and just kind of write notes, and we'll talk after the game. Good luck, guys.
All right, sounds good.
Awesome. All right, this is such a pleasure having Kevin just randomly hop on. We've got QXC here. Actually just hopping in. Apparently he's friends with Orosama. And yeah, it's really good to have his advice as well, you know. There about how he was letting the Terran kind of rally across the map and just set up and all that sort of stuff. So you guys are talking about rapid fire there in chat. There is a link down below the stream in the frequently asked questions if you want a link to the rapid fire. Hopefully Kevin and stuff, you guys can't hear me, can you? Don't think so. Check it. Here's the information, Furiously. There you go. That's all the information on setting up rapid fire. We'll take a little bit of effort to, you know, read through, make sure you've got it right, but it can be really good. Poutine says, oh my god, you lost weight. Yeah, a while ago, actually. It's nice, because I haven't been working out much at all. I really need to work out super hard this afternoon, or I'm going to turn into a fucking slug. And I got to work out tomorrow as well, actually, because I'm going to be flying. And if I'm not working out and staying fit when I travel, I get fucked. So I just get destroyed by the air travel, even more than normal. And it's going to be bad going to Katowice anyway. So, yeah, but I lost a lot of weight, and even though I haven't been exercising, I'm still staying a lot lighter than I was before, which is nice. You just have more energy, and it's nice just kind of not spamming as much food and shit. So I really am going to push him to go pool first in future, but for now, he's comfortable with this opening, so we're going to let him stay on that opening. I do really think pool first is a better way to do this, though. Yeah, because he gives a little bit too much of an opportunity for a well-microed Reaper to be a pain in the ass. He can probably get away with it to an insanely high level, though. Pull first. And two things to delay CC. Otherwise, same opening. Everything will converge and be very similar. Once you get used to it. But the big thing here is really for him to focus on, like I said, his mid game. I felt like his opening was quite okay. Definitely there can be issues. Holding certain things, I'm always a bit uncomfortable when I see someone go light on queens and go for a fast baneling nest. I feel like it's a less efficient way of defending certain hellbat timings. But I think he should be fine. It's not like he'll fall behind. If he does things correctly, he'll be at least even against a lot of these pressures. QXC doing some fancy Reaper micro is trying to take down this creep tumor, and I think he's actually going to get it. It is regenerating, so it will take three more bombs. So actually, he probably won't get it in time. Let me bring up the hotkeys. So we can see what's going on. Nice! QXC gets a creep tumor there. That's a big pickup. That's really nice. The FPS seems really good right now, whereas when I was playing it was a bit all over the place. Maybe it's just because I was moving my screen around a bit too much, I don't know. Me and Maynard going to be flying together. I wish. Maynard's flying from Adelaide, though, so he does have a little bit of a different flight. I think I fly through Vienna on the way there. I think Doha, and then Vienna. And then I've never been to Qatar. I don't even really know exactly what Doha is, except that it is the capital of Qatar. 800,000 people. Cool. Qatar. Awesome. Was I like, oh my god, last night about the GSR results? I actually stayed up late and watched it. Because I was like, oh, hype. You know, I really wanted to see how they went. I was pretty surprised at how it was going. This Reaper's being a real pain in the ass. I like that QXC is doing this, you know, taking advantage of the fact that Link Speed's so late, seeing everything, and this really gives him comfort. Interestingly, QXC appears to be doing the Widow Mine variation of the 2-on-1. So you do a double medevac drop, but... Oh, he's gonna be... Okay, the third medevac will come with the Widow Mine. Yeah. Okay, cool. His first drop is actually coming incredibly fast. But it's good. You can tell QXC is just not worried about any sort of aggression because he saw there was no Zergling speed. He knew what he was up against and everything looked good. I love that the Evo chambers are a little bit later with this build. That's what really makes me enjoy it. I do think you can probably get a bit further ahead doing a different opening. Yeah, but it's good enough for now. I think it gets the job done. I don't see a need to change what he's doing. Because there's so many areas you can choose to improve on in StarCraft. And since his build is already decent, you know, it's not bad by any means. Just focusing on that mid-game and really kind of being more aggressive and being more resourceful with his Ling Bane Muter is going to be pretty big. Of course, QXC, for anyone who doesn't know, is one of the best pro gamers in the very early days of StarCraft 2. Had a very famous moment where he all-killed IM, which was the best team in Korea at the time in GSTL. An all-kill, of course, is where you beat every single player in the team league format, where it's, you know, it's kind of King of the Hill format. You both get up to four players to go in. He went in first and just killed the entire team, and it was like, holy shit. That was a long time ago. I think that was 2011. And that was one of the very few famous moments where foreigners did well against Koreans in the early days of StarCraft 2. Yeah, Ayoshi, I'm trying not to spoil as well, even though I showed part of the game in today's daily. By the way, guys, if you do want a really dirty all-in for ZvT, check out today's daily. It's linked in chat. Sorry, I was on the wrong camera there for a little while. Okay. So, 55 Zerglings all on QXC's side of the map. Really bad. That's a big mistake. Hey, thanks for the follow. Zerglings all on QXC's side of the map. At 7 minutes. Greedy. Splitting 20 Lings off to do this would have been sick. I do love that once you saw the drops, though, you used the steel mechanic. Well done. Good transfuses over here. This is always such a frustrating battle. You're just like, just die, Marines! And they just won't, but great transfuses. I'd say that's more frustrating for the Terran than the Zerg, as long as you do control it properly. Okay, so he's really got a drone up. Like, right fucking now. Oh my god, he misclicked his drones in the main there. He's got some idle workers all over the place. QXC is just, you know, he's a master of throwing opponents off and putting the aggression on them. And I feel like he's really thrown off Arasama's rhythm. Needs to drone really hard right fucking now. Also, where's the Bane speed? So, okay. You got way too thrown off. And QXC's aggression. Some nice counters, but not good enough defense at home. Oh, I guess it's okay. Some nice counterattacks worked out. But I kind of wish he did just drone up a bit harder. and defend all four bases while spreading creep. He's really got to respread his creep on the southern side. So Bane speed and 2-2 should always take priority over Spire. Bane, don't forget Bane speed. So I gave him a little bit of a cheat there, because otherwise he'd just be screwed. He's already in a pretty good spot, but he's got to respread his creep as well right now. Like, the problem is because he's like getting over eager and counterattacking, he's not doing basic things like respreading his creep, and he's letting his whole rhythm get thrown off. And I think that plays into the Terran player's hands when you're playing this sort of, you know, four base macro Ling Bane style. He's building a single Corruptor, which is interesting. It is time to transfer workers out of this main base. Didn't do it just yet. Great creep spread through the middle of the map. Not sure what he's focusing on right now, though. Okay, 8 overlords are on the way, that's good. Big supply block there. Oh man, 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 oh my gosh. Okay. 10 minutes. Could have taken this engage. It was just a few bio units. What should you have done differently? He should have split back half the army, which would have made it easier to then spread the Lings forward and drag those Widow Mine shots away from the core of your force. This isn't scary. Like, this shouldn't really do much. You'll just kill a few Zergans that flood and just go up there. Does he not have Banelings? Baneling speed has now finished. Yeah, he's fine. This is just QXC being annoying. Don't chase it, and you'll be fine. You should probably split off a drop defense squad at this point. So we'll see if he does do that. 66 drones. He's at that magic count. He needs to keep transferring workers, though. Main has not transferred. Natural hasn't transferred. Needs to transition those workers over, because he hasn't done that. He's in big trouble. And right now, he's lost overlords on the southern side of the map, so he's kind of a bit short on vision. There's no vision on the north side. There's no vision on the south side. And that's really problematic. Okay, he's going to keep trying to push back QXC here, but QXC has... Yeah, here comes QXC's actual army. Oh, and QXC just massacres everything. And that's cool. So yeah, I think if he just kind of defended the aggression, built a big round of drones, got his three base saturation up, that would be good. And I think even with that number of Zerglings, he still could have counterattacked the third and done that damage. There's just too much Terran. Alright. GG, guys. Well played.
That's how it always feels. Just too much bloody Terran.
Alright, so I think you were doing really well that game. I think QXC was doing exactly what is annoying when you don't open up Zergling speed, which is just being a dick with his Reaper, which is fantastic. You handled it decently, though.
Yeah, I didn't think it was that big of a deal. He killed one creep tumor. That was some bullshit. And I lost an overlord, and that also threw me off a little. But, you know, I don't think the Reaper was that big of a deal.
No, not at all. I'm just kind of saying, like, he was annoying. He was good. He didn't let you get away with it for free. And QXC also, you know, didn't care too much about aggression, because you couldn't do anything off that opening. There's no Zergan speed. That's fine. So the openings were fine. I feel like you lost your rhythm after the 2-1-1 first hit. I feel like you kind of got a bit overeager, and there was this moment where, rather than droning up, you had a nice 50 drone count, you had three bases, a fourth going down. You defended the drop, QXC pulled back a little bit, you didn't know where the drops were, and you just kind of clicked all your Zerglings across the map. And then QXC dropped the fourth, he dropped your main, and you reacted quite well under pressure, and you split your Lings in half, and you dealt with it decently. But then you were just frozen, not droning for about 3.5 minutes. And even though you cleared out Kevin's third, like what, twice, three times.
That's good. I was like, did I win?
And if you were droning at the same time, I think you would have, because you actually had plenty of Zerglings, but you just kind of like, if you split off 10, 15 Zerglings to that third, you still would have done a lot of damage and you should have stayed at home. So just try to get in that defensive rhythm. And then because from there, the momentum just kept, you know, being all over the place, you like never respread the creep on the southern side outside your natural.
Because you kept looking for
aggressive fights and stuff. And it took you probably until, I don't know, 9 minutes or something to actually fully drone your 66 drones. And then I could tell you were thrown out of whack. You were doing things like, you know, sending drones to the gas and misclicking. You never transitioned workers from your main and natural over to the fourth because you lost that rhythm. So whenever you do defend something, rather than feeling any sort of urgency to get on the Terran side of the map, think of it as bonus points if you split off some lings for a counter or to keep an eye on him. But your number one priority is, oh, there's no pressure on me. Spread creep. Build drones if I feel comfortable, you know, get up to that three base saturation and then mass army and spread creep. And otherwise, I think, like, you know, pretty good play. You did a better job of splitting off drop defense. Just to keep that rhythm. Don't freeze up on droning once you defend the pressure. You know, mix a round of drones. If you're unsure, build a round of drones, build a round of units. Soon enough, you're at three base saturation anyway. And that's something I do a lot because there is always a little bit of, oh, I don't really have the scouting. I forgot to oversee a scout or something. Did he go fast third CC and cut production and power a little bit and go up to five barracks? Or is he just nonstop being queuing Marines and he's going to rock up with two more medevacs and two widow mines and combat shields and I'll die if I don't build some units? So it's fine for you to not be sure and to play sort of in the middle, but you do need to have some droning going on. So overall, not bad play at all. If Kevin has one skill which has existed throughout his entire career of StarCraft 2, it's to fucking tilt his opponent like a madman and throw them off and just such good drops and multi-prong and kind of, you know, poking around. I feel like Kevin always gets used to always get under my skin when we used to play as well. It was like, this is just so fucking irritating. Like, you're the spirit of Terran, man. Just get the fuck out of my base.
But that's fun. That's good practice.
Exactly. I've always played Belshire. Belshire's decent map. New
Kirk's
front on.
I remember Belshire.
Back.
Yeah.
All right. I'm hosting up. Whoops. Sorry, Kevin. Let me accept your friend request so I can invite you.
Awesome. And another thing you can do is when you know, so like on Newkirk, there's a pretty common drop path just from one base to another. If you just leave one ling at that like rock area. Like
base with the rocks. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just, I think I did that at some point, but I wasn't smart enough to do it preemptively.
Yeah. You know, with a lot of the drops, just like 1 or 2 seconds of pre-warning can make all the difference. That's the difference between losing, you know, 16 drones and losing 2 drones.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a really good point, actually, as well, because there's also, I'm not sure if you've been doing it, Austin, but after you, like, defend the 2-1-1, or sometimes if you see the angle it's coming from, you can just like click your Zerglings underneath the medevacs. And that annoys Terran no end. Because then the Terran's like, fuck, now I need to go find a ledge to drop on. Yeah,
that's what I feel. I feel like they just fly to the edge of your main and they drop back and forth and just kill all your Zerglings.
Well, it depends on the map position, right? But often after you defend their first poke-in, you can just click on the medevacs with your Zerglings and they don't really get a chance to unload, or they've got to go really far back. And it just you don't want to fall into that like trap of like, oh, you threw back the drop and then you just pull back onto creep and the Terran just drops like just out of your vision off creep and just stims straight back in and kills your queens or your creep tumors. Like you can do these little moves where you just stay under the drops for an extra 20 seconds and it just takes momentum away from the Terran and forces him to use a lot more APM. Yeah. Otherwise the Terran, it's so easy for him to get in his rhythm. And the Terran has a lot of shit to do at home. Terran's really mechanically demanding. So every little thing you do to actually force them to do something else, it takes a lot of the wind out of the Terran's sails. That's a very minor thing. It's just those little things do add up over time.
That's great.
All right.
Correct to my erroneous views.
Let's get in this mindset. Let's do it. You played well last game. Only thing you've got to change up is build a few more drones after you defend the first pressure. Get up to that three base saturation. Don't send all your lings across the map. Otherwise, keep playing it out the way you are. Kick some ass. Good luck, guys.
Yep, thanks.
Awesome. All right. Hey, machine gun. Oh, I'm a machine gun. Thank you so much for subscribing. Appreciate that, mate. Yeah, we've got QXC playing Return of John Lennon. QXC is a bit sexier than John Lennon. Just as talented, though. Just as talented. His bandana shook the world. You guys are funny. Cool. Yeah, hopefully you guys are enjoying this coaching. This is cool, because this is like a master level Terran coaching. I'm saving a lot of these coaching VODs, and a lot of them, you guys are going to see, because I'm not going to have that many like fully prepared dailies going up while I'm away. I'm going to try and record a lot this afternoon, a lot tomorrow afternoon. Hopefully I'll get 5, 6, 7 dailies recorded. More likely it'll only be 3 or 4 good ones. So, but there's going to be about 4, 5, 6 coaching VODs going up. So yeah, check out my YouTube channel. Keep an eye on it over the next week or two while I'm at Katowice. There will be a lot of coaching VODs going up. Most of them Zerg. I think I've saved 1 or 2 Terran coaching VODs, which will be going up as well. Hopefully a Protoss player wants some coaching soon. I think I did actually get contacted by a Protoss player finally, which is cool because I just would like to have a bit more Protoss coaching content going up. My Protoss is a lot better than my Terran. Mechanically, I'm just more comfortable with it. But anyway, guys, this is pretty cool. This is pretty cool. Thought QXC went insane trying to win TV Van Hots. I mean, there was one clip of him getting mad, and there was definitely a frustrating era of TVP where it was like, oh my god, how do I defend Blink? And then someone would just do like a Void Ray 3 or 4 gate all in, and you'd be like, are you kidding me? It was a little bit painful for Terran during that era, but QXC is really successful, guys. You guys should all check out his board game. Let's give QXC a little bit of a shout out. QXC board game. The name is eluding me right now. I really want to order it. Yeah. Aeon's End, right? For eons. So check it out. Here's the Kickstarter page. It's already been fully funded and everything, but you guys should check it out. Apparently it's a really good board game. I don't know if he's released the expansion yet, but I think it's like going out soon. So yeah, I've been playing a lot more board games recently. I love that that's like a cool thing now, is everyone's into gaming. And yeah, should be fun. I trust a StarCraft player who played as a pro for a long time to understand complex games. Thanks for the link there, Nah. Appreciate it. That's probably better than the Kickstarter page. Kickstarter was just the first thing that came up. I do like that model as well for a board game. Like, you get a Kickstarter going, and basically it's like people pre-ordering it before you even make it. And then having the potential to, you know, to get the bonus goals with it as well. Do I know how QXC got his name? No, I do not. See, this is a pretty good pattern. Pretty good pattern with this opening. Oris Armor. I like it. I like when someone plays their own opening in like a logical way. You know, part of me is like, yeah, I kind of wish you went, you know, more queens off it. But then I look at the way it's playing out, and I'm like, fuck that. No, this is good. Maybe there's potentially some weakness at super, super high level of play, but we're not coaching pro gaming level. This is 5k MMR, right? This is a good player, bunch of good players. QXC is probably quite a bit better. I don't know how much he's been practicing, but many years of being a pro gamer doesn't just instantly disappear overnight. So it's cool to see them just kind of playing his own way. And it's all about his rhythm, though, once he gets into this mid-game. In terms of how he's injecting and so on, like, I personally am not the biggest fan of how he uses that mechanic. But I think it's fine. It's not, like, the most game-breaking thing. There's always 4,000 different areas you can choose to improve on. So that's a mistake. Okay, here we go. Detail right there. So enough rambling for me. Let's actually write a note here for Austin. So here we see game 2. Same mistake as game 1. I didn't want to harp on about it because he didn't actually... I was like, yeah, that happens sometimes. But he's not having queens in front, and he doesn't have spotting overlords. These are 2 things. Okay. So 2 big little things, I want to call this. Queens always stand in front of creep tumors. Of growing creep tumors. So don't spread it right to the edge at the start. A good Terran will always look for the snipe. You'll see me look for the snipe 1 in 5 games, which is how you know I'm not a good Terran player. But they'll always look for that snipe. Not only that, you need spotting overlords. So at the moment, your pattern is wrong. Your first 2 overlords are great, but then you prioritize drops spotting way too early. Your third, fourth, and sometimes even fifth on Belshire with three paths. Overlords all need to spot out front your natural and third. Now, why is that third? Why is that important? Why? Because otherwise you won't be in position to block Reaper Scouts, Hellion Runbys, or any other general harassment. So guys, to show you exactly what I'm talking about, there should have been an Overlord here, here, and here on this map. That's not important at this stage of the game once your creep starts getting out, once you start having Lings on the watchtowers. And after you've got that vision, only then do you want to get these Overlords on the edges of the map, filling in those holes. And that's something which is important against Protoss as well, or you won't be able to track Adept movement. It's important against Zerg. Not exactly the same, but you want some key areas of vision on the map to see where the Ling Bane's coming from and how aggressive your opponent's being, and if they're pulling back or committing more. That's really important. So first two Overlords go to the Terran's base, one out front, one to sacrifice, or sometimes two out front, depending on the map. And yeah, it's important to do that. So 61 drones here. Now, he's droning a little bit harder than normal. He just built like eight Overlords, I think it was. Yeah, which is not too bad, but he doesn't have a fourth base, and that's getting to be problematic. Okay. Droned up your three base much better this game. However, you need to retake that fourth. You didn't respread creep on the right hand side, even though your queens were there. Just respread that creep, mass Ling Bane, and retake that position. You deserve that fourth base. Need it up. Yeah, you need it started no later than 7:30 with this style. You still did get it down at 8 minutes, so not too bad. And you can see his upgrades are ahead, but he really needs to reassert his map control right now. So there's a drop there, and he's struggling with the mechanics. Okay. I'm thinking of telling him drop defense squad. You know what? I'm not going to do it. But if he gets dropped more and he doesn't go put out a drop defense squad, then I'm going to get really uptight about it. I'm like, you need to do this. Still need to work on getting that drop squad going. You were too afraid of Kevin this game. You were up in supply, up in upgrades. And let him cancel your fourth twice more. You should have had the watchtower. How do you judge this? How do you judge this stuff? So he might be struggling with his game sense. Well, how do you judge it? You've saturated three bases, taken no direct damage. After a few rounds of units and 1-1 finishing, there is a 0% chance the Terran can maintain his position on the map. You will just massively outnumber him. Oh my god, the drops just ran straight past him. But right now, Kevin's just doing a two-pronged push, right? So what he needs to do is he needs to split up. And he's doing it, but he's doing it wrong. He's splitting off a drop squad for the main army, and he's got his main army following what is the drop. So what he's not doing here is he's not realizing that the roles have changed. At 10 minutes... Kevin changed roles. His left became his frontal push, and his right became the drop. You were a little slow to react to this. However, it might just be because you are on the back foot from earlier a little bit. Oh god, oh god, oh god. Spread. Okay, he's doing okay. Yeah, he's got this. Clean this up. Just don't sacrifice the muters. Pull the drones and he'll be fine. Don't sacrifice the muters. Pull the drones and you'll be fine. Oh, don't worry. Focus on the main. The fourth is dead. Focus on the main. Look at the fight. Please tell me his muters are staying alive. I think there wasn't... Yeah, okay. There wasn't enough marines and mines up in the main. So he's a little bit lucky there. It was very hard to judge how many marines got into those medevacs. So a little bit of a risky scenario there. I think that might have been a manual retarget by QXC. I'm not sure. Okay. Did that go to him or not? I don't even know. But yeah, he's got to try to break him. If he doesn't break him, he's just gonna lose. And it's better for the game to end now rather than to have it fizzle out and waste too much time. I'd be happy to coach for one more game if these guys are both still free and available. But it's just so many Widow Mines from Kevin. Holy shit. Too many Banes as well. Not enough Zerglings.
The multi-prong.
Right. Yeah, that was tough.
Well, no, though. I cornered him. I can kill all this crap on the left. Ah, oh, fuck, there's the fourth gone.
GG, well played. Alright, so we can play one more game after this, or we can just watch that replay if you want to do a little bit of extra time. Either way, the most important points of that game. Let's just hop into the replay. Let's talk about it, right? Obviously, Kevin is a bloody hard opponent, so I'm just
gonna... Yeah, I wasn't expecting to to make that happen, but, you know, it's good practice.
Can you make me the party leader, Kevin?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. All right, I'll load up the replay. Yeah, it's good practice for sure, and it's really good because you play someone who's a bit better, and it really forces you to be quick on a lot of these things and kind of memorize those like mechanical, just muscle memory reactions you need. So... I've got heaps of notes, which for you, you know, I'd love for you to rewatch the replays and read through the notes afterwards. But for now, main things. Okay, creep tumors. Kevin got a creep tumor again. Good players will always try to snipe your tumors. So general rule there, your queens should always be in front of the creep tumor. Sorry?
Oh, he got one of the third early?
Third base. Yeah. So your queen should always be standing in front of the creep tumors. You should never spread it to the very edge. That's just something you do in the early stage to be safe.
I did my natural, and I got greedy at the third.
Yeah. The other big thing here is actually really big, because that made me realize something else which is lacking. And this might carry over to your other matchups as well, which is your Overlord vision. So your first two Overlords are just fine. They both get in position, but after that, it's very important to have your Overlord spotting for Reapers and Hellions, right? Now, this is not as important against 2-1-1 because it's just the Reaper.
Right.
But even getting early warning of that Reaper allows you to shut down its scouting, which means the Terran's in the dark. Terran with a 2-1-1 needs to make sure his wall is up at his natural before he leaves. He can't, you know, cut a corner and say, oh, this guy's just massing drones. I can just walk across the map. You know, I can be a bit greedier. So what you need is after your first two Overlords on this map, make sure you're on everyone's camera. You should have an Overlord there.
Yep.
There and there. So this map's special. You actually need three Overlords. It's especially important against Hellion play.
Afraid to leave them over open ground. Don't they just die? I feel like that's... I'm always afraid to leave them in a place where Marines will just gun them down.
If you lose an Overlord, doesn't really matter. It's not the end of the world. It's one Overlord at 5 minutes, 25 minutes, 30. But yes, you can manually pull those back. But it's really important to try and use that vision to shut out the Reaper early on. And especially against Hellion play, if you don't have those Overlords in position, you're just not going to be in position to stop the Hellions, and you're going to need to, you know, they can run by, or they can suddenly hit your natural with Hellbats, and you won't see it until the Hellbats are walking into your natural, and your queens might be at your third. So it's very important to get those Overlords out. And the thing is, they're not that far out. your creep should be getting close to out there anyway. And if you lose one to a double medevac drop, it's spotted the drop. It's not the end of the world. Usually you realize it's a two medevac play. You can say, oh, okay, I can pull those overlords back just a little bit if I really want to. A lot of the time you can just forget to, and that's fine. But against adepts, you 100% need this, or shit will just, you know, they'll hide to adepts and shade into a third and kill eight drones and you'll lose the game. Hellions will dart in, kill eight drones because your queens are up at the natural. So that sort of stuff is very important. It'll also help you with the Reaper running in and sniping creep tumors, and it'll also allow you to deny the Reaper scout. It's a small detail which can give a lot of edges across all three matchups. So that Overlord vision is something which, as a general rule, is very good. Beyond that, what happened? You did well. You droned up your bases. Now, you didn't manage to secure the fourth as early. That's okay. It's hard to get that fourth on this map. It's kind of awkward to get down there. But there was a point there where you lost momentum. So let's fast forward to that point. You know, I like the way your build kind of pans out. I like the way you're playing it. It's all pretty decent.
I feel my early game is really strong. I don't feel like there's any huge deficiencies there.
Yeah, I don't think you need to change anything. I think it's pretty cool. Oh, this Reaper man.
The only thing with the early game is you gave me too much vision, too much control here.
I couldn't spread the creep right, and
it's
pushed the creep back.
Basically, how StarCraft works: if you control the center of the map, you control the shortest distance from any two points.
Sure.
And because you didn't have creep coming down the center area. Later on, it makes it really easy for me to do a lot of multi-prong stuff.
Yeah.
I found that my thinking was that if anything, creep down the right side is more important because that's where the fights are going to be happening, especially with the fourth and all of that. I typically prioritize creep down the right side. Do you think it's better to emphasis on that?
I think the right watchtower is the most important. So you do need like creep out front that natural on the left, but the right watchtower, like everything kind of converging towards that point and then beyond that watchtower is like the most important because it's the kind of the same thing as Kevin's saying. Like that's, if you've got that watchtower, you're equidistant to your fourth, your main.
Yeah, that's true. Did a good job denying it.
So if your creep to the watchtower comes this way or this way.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's good shit.
Okay, so the Overlord would have stopped that creep tumor on the left getting sniped by that Reaper because you would have spotted it ahead of time and cancelled on or not spread it right in front of the Reaper. So already it's small, but it makes a difference. Now
that would make a huge creep would be so much farther out.
Exactly. So let's watch from 5 minutes. And what I want to talk about here is your game sense. So this is where things went wrong, and this might just be the Kevin effect, where you're like, okay, you know, he's a bit better than me. He's really good with his multitasking, and sometimes when you're playing someone a bit better than you, you start to lock up a little bit. This happens to pro gamers as well. You know, Artosis and Tasteless were talking about maybe it's happening with Stats yesterday, where, you know, after his first game where he just got demolished by Innovation, it was like, okay, is this happening? But what happens here is you defend the push. You kill most of the Marines. You take, you know, this is okay for you. You then decide, you know what, I don't need to overbuild units. I'm going to drone a bit harder, which I like. This is good. This makes me happy. Respread creep. This is great up to this point. And then there's a point at like 6:30 where things start to pan out. Sorry, what are you saying?
No, I thought of you and you said, pull back, just drone up, get your base in order and don't. What I wanted to do there was counterattack, see if his wall was down, see if he had a third up. I didn't.
Awesome. I think it's good. I mean, you've got the single Zergling spotting the third. You'll know if there's like a very fast third that goes down. It gives you some sort of understanding of where Kevin's at. I do think, you know, squeezing in like an Overseer when your lair finishes is great. Your lair is quite late this game, but it's actually acceptable. I don't mind that. I think it's more important to focus on your defense, your creep, your drone count. The only thing that really delays is your 1-1, which still ends up miles ahead of... your 2-2, which ends up miles ahead of Kevin's.
I tried to time the lair so it would be about when 1-1 finished, the lair would be finished. Maybe it's a little late.
It's like 40 seconds late or something. It's not massive. Not even that. It's like 20 seconds.
20 seconds.
Yeah, it's not massive. Okay. You're still way ahead. So anyway, this is the point where you freeze up though. From about 6:30. So Kevin does this next wave of pressure. You defend it just fine. You're in an okay position. You've respread creep trimmers on the left. And then he comes in. And this is not a big pressure. This is a couple of Marines. He does a nice little scan. Kevin's just looking for damage. He's being quite economic at home. And you freeze up. Now, you've droned up your three bases, so you're probably feeling a little bit like, oh shit, I'm not sure I can engage that. I haven't really been building Zerglings. I don't have Banelings.
I didn't have vision yet either for the mines. I start building a spore.
Right.
Hoping to move it up and reclaim some control. But
okay. I think you can almost just like walk your queens into that. Like what I would do right now is I just walk up. I just engage, tank the Widowmine shots. Because the
moment, I guess with the
queens. Yeah, with the queens or even with the Zerglings. If his marines are still there, just run your Zerglings in, spread them the way you normally would, and that's fine. Because this really just like psychologically pushes you into a corner. And from here, you sit back and you have way more army than Kevin over the next few minutes. So think about this. You've defended, you've taken no damage, you've defended well. Not only have you defended, you've killed some of Kevin's units. Whenever you kill units off a 2-1-1, it's going to favor you as the Zerg player usually because it weakens their follow-up pressures. You've got creep going out, you've got queens, you've now saturated three bases. So over the next minute, you should have a mental tab in your head which says, I am now getting ahead of you in army. Why am I getting ahead of you in army? Because I saturated my three bases, you don't have a natural down, and all I'm doing is building army units from this moment. And I think about 720 or so, you really should feel very confident with all these lings flooding out that you can overwhelm. But I think maybe it's the Widow Mines, maybe it's something else, but you didn't even respread creep tumors from the third base. Something about those Widow Mines got in your head and you kind of sat in your corner of the map. And you could be controlling the Watchtower right now. You could have overwhelmed that even if you don't get a spore down to those Widow Mines, which you could have. You could have got rid of it, put creep tumors down around it, brought the spore up, got rid of it. You could have the Watchtower. And what does Kevin have on the map right now? Not that much. You've got plenty of units. And
in my head, I was trying to wait for Overseers. That's what I was waiting for. And I just sat back waiting for it. And that's garbage. Should have pushed out earlier.
That's really good, actually, though. Like, do you think you felt you had enough units to engage him? Like, do you think you had that understanding? Like, if I had an Overseer, I'd be immediately back out there on the map and taking control of this position?
I wouldn't say that I thought I was this far ahead in units. Like, looking at this now, I have, like, I just have like boatloads more units than he could ever deal with. Yep. And I definitely didn't feel that. I felt like I definitely could have contested and pushed back out on the map, but I didn't realize I was as far ahead in units as I was, for sure.
Yeah, so there's two things that, it's partly experience, right? Because you're not used to reading this situation. One is you're not always droning as hard after the pressure. This time you droned really hard, you did a really nice job of it. The other part is, normally once you defend the pressure, you then build another 20 drones. In this case, you're like, hey, I've got three bases saturated, keep building Ling Bane, because that's the new exercise. Keep in mind, as you pump out that Ling Bane, if Terran hasn't molested you at all, you're going to have way more shit, and he has no business being on your side of the map. And that's, you know, what allows you to get the fourth base and to spread your creep uninterrupted, which is where, as we were talking about before, that's where your advantages come from, that creep spread. So if you just pushed out there a little bit earlier, this whole 2-minute period where he cancels your fourth multiple times would have been completely different, because you would have confidently asserted yourself. You would have been like, bam, Watchtower is mine. Get the fuck off my side of the map. This little poke on the left, four Marines, bam. You just control, you know, grab some Zerglings, put them on number three, send them over to deal with that. Instead, this whole area on the right was dark for so long that you were very unsure what you were going into. You're so slow to respread the creep here. So I think that was the real period of the game where things came undone for you. I think with this style, you're always going to feel a little bit uncomfortable if Terran goes 2-1-1, keeps bringing medevacs, keeps pressuring hard, does it properly, about taking a fourth, right? You feel a bit unconfident. You're like, can I put a fourth base down? Oh, my fourth's a bit delayed. Whereas if a Terran doesn't go, you know, quite as aggressive, or you shut down the drop hard, or it's a map where the fourth base is closer and you've already got creep there, you have a much faster fourth. But this is the exact same situation we see a lot of pros get into, where they go, oh shit, you denied my fourth a few times. This is annoying. But guess what? I have 2-2 faster than you because you haven't actually killed any of my units effectively, and I've got more army supply. And there's potentially a huge 2-2 Lingbane muta timing where you just crash into the Terran on 3 base. Or you simply control the map, spread creep all over the place, and if the Terran overextends at any moment, you jump on top of his army, and you know, you get way ahead that way. So that's me, kind of. I just wanted to kind of explain that all, so I kind of went on a whole ranting blur and just kind of said all of that. But hopefully that all makes sense.
I think you hit the nail on the head that I was just afraid to move out, and that spiraled out into a lot of things. I didn't have map control. I was afraid to take the fourth because the fourth was on the other side of what was in my head, Kevin's wall of units.
Yeah.
Exactly. If I assert myself more on the map, I think that would fix almost all of these problems.
Awesome. Yeah, and like those like points, yeah, where like you start to make like a little mistake here or there, and it's like, I never like to look at a ZvT and look at like, oh, it's 20 minutes in and you made this slight mistake. Like, I definitely think you can always gain something from doing that. It's always good to be critical. Oh, in this messy situation, I should make a note to do this better. But I think like you get the most value out of being like, where did I lose control of the game? Because the moment you lose control, that's where mistakes proliferate. And it's great training to get better in those messy situations. But if you want to win more games, it's usually better to, you know, control the pace of the game in the first place.
One thing you can do with this big army, like, so in the previous game, you decided to like 1A across the map with everything. But there's a balance between keeping everything at home and doing that. You can send like 10, 12 lings, and if I don't have any units at my third, that can be actually really disruptive.
Okay. Like here, your third is, like, I'd have to find an interesting path to it, because you're a high ground in between your net and your third is well guarded. But
yeah, at this point, my third is walled off, so you'd be looking at denying the fourth. But early on, like, those barracks and depot and stuff, that doesn't just appear magically. Like, there's a window where there's nothing really there.
I still feel like I could run around to the left, get up on the like the left part of the high ground, and run into the third unhindered and do some disruption.
Sure. And I think a big one as well is if you have more map control, you see like this army moving out, right? And whenever you identify the Terran just moved out with all this stuff, especially if you're already in this mindset of, well, I'm controlling the map. I've got vision everywhere. I've got 60 Zerglings pre-split off. I know I can at least buy time, if not defend the army on creep, you know, with the rest of my army. Yeah. You got 60 Zerglings just chilling on the right-hand side of the map. You see him hit the watchtower and you just like run into the natural and split into the main and natural and, you know, start to, you know, you overwhelm the rally, kill some SCVs. So you can go for those big, like, sort of wild maneuvers as well. But being short of such a comfortable position that you feel comfortable doing that, I love what Kevin said there. Like, you know, go back to the 7 minute mark. Oh, I've got some excess units. Maybe I'm not quite confident engaging just yet. Or maybe I am, and I am engaging. But shit, why not split 12 Zerglings off to hit the third right at this moment? What's Kevin got at home? You know, not a lot, right?
Yeah, almost nothing.
So yeah, sometimes just doing something small like that can be helpful.
And I feel like if I did that, I would die, but I totally wouldn't.
Yeah. So it's really nice to just mix in those little things. And the thing is, you've got to think about it not in terms of this needs to do damage, but it's always about that APM and momentum war in TVZ. The more you force the Terran to look at home, the harder it is for him to do what, I don't know, I like to call these the douchebag moves, right? Where it's like, you go, you force him to lift, he picks up and drops on the low ground. You're like, oh shit, he's there, and he picks up and drops on the high ground. And he picks up and drops on the low ground, you lose track of it because you're injecting, he snipes in and kills your fourth. He can't do that if there's a couple Zerglings on his side of the map. Like, that completely invalidates his APM restrictions. Like, he just can't do it. So, little moves like that are really awesome. Overall, though, I like the way you played it, and I like the way you droned harder this game. Yep. And I feel like there's a lot of things that go right, and it's just this one area of the game where you lost control of the right-hand side, which undid everything else. So, even if there's Widow Mines, just get back out there. Don't be afraid to engage into them. Spread your units against it. I can't remember if it was any of these game, if it was this game or the previous one. There was definitely one or two moments where you could have spread your units a little bit better versus Widow Mines. Everyone makes mistakes against Widow Mines. So, I mean, technique-wise, I think you're doing it right. You're just trying to pull Zerglings forward, right? Whenever you go into
just kind of split them off at ends. Yeah, and
kind of through the Terran army, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You're kind of peeling off those front layers and sending them through. So I thought you were doing that. Not everyone, you know, you can't do it perfectly every time. Sometimes you're injecting or microing something else, or you just misclick. And that happens. And it's fine to take some terrible Widow Mine shots. Just don't get tilted by it. I don't think you do. I coach a lot of players who are massively tilted after one bad Widow Mine shot. But for every one of those, there's a Widow Mine that kills 10 Marines.
Widow Mines on Zerglings don't affect me. Widow Mines on Mutas, I get pissed off real fast.
Yes. Exactly. Zergling Baneling ratio. Way too many Banelings here as the game went on. So I think you morph even more Banelings. Like, I was like, you need to go break him.
When you said to go A move his third, I was like, hell, I have a lot of gas. Let's just blow it on Banelings and just roll in, see what can happen.
Yeah.
That's not normal, but yeah.
That can work against someone who's like heavy Marine, low on Widow Mines. Look at Kevin's Widow Mine. He actually doesn't have that many right now, but he's building them three at a time. He's got a second factory. And he just has so many Widow Mines, and he's got his Marauder micro, you know, Marauders out front, Marine spreading. If you don't have Zerglings, your trades just become so inefficient, because if the Terran micros correctly, there is zero way that you can take a good fight. Whereas Zerglings are the key to a good engagement, because if your Banelings force the spread, the Zerglings get the surround, you roll the Terran army.
Yep.
Cool. Okay, all in all, good play, man. GG's. All right, we got to round up.
Yeah.
So we went a bit over time, so we'll try to... I'll just count that as an hour, 10 minutes. So we went an hour, 20. Throw in a little bonus 10 minutes there, because it was a lot of fun having Kevin on as well. We had some memes popping up in chat.
I had to... I did some practicing today. I haven't played StarCraft in forever.
Looking in pretty good form still, man.
It's fun.
It's like riding a bike.
Yeah, best game.
Hells yeah, man. How's the board game going, by the way? Like, is the expansion